we've finally made it to the stars. When we look up at the night sky, the stars seem like tiny, remote points of light. But over the last century or more, astronomers have been able to use many of the tools we've already described to measure stars' distances, sizes, temperatures, compositions, masses, and even lifespans. In this chapter, we'll look at what we can measure about the stars, see how they can be arranged into different categories by luminosity and temperature, and learn how we can estimate how long a star can last.
We'll start by looking at what we can measure about stars. This includes three things that impact each other: distance, brightness, and luminosity. If you know any two of these, you can figure out the third.
Then we'll look at how we can measure a star's temperature and spectral type, which proves to be closely related. We'll also use spectra to find the composition of stars. And of course, we can use Newtonian gravity to measure a star's mass.
Then we'll spend some time learning how these properties let us categorize the great variety of stars using the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram, a powerful tool for organizing what we know about stars. We'll also see how we can use basic ideas of the physics of stars to calculate the star's lifetime.
And finally, we'll look at groups of stars known as clusters. Stars in a star cluster are all about the same age, so these act as important laboratories to test our ideas about stellar lifetimes and stellar evolution, the central idea in the next chapter. Distance is one of the most fundamental things we need to know about a star. Most of the other things we measure about it will depend on how far away it is. So knowing distance can be crucial for knowing stars. In particular, the distance is closely related to brightness and luminosity. Brightness is the most obvious measure of how a star looks. Brightness is how much light we see when we observe the star from here on Earth.
On the other hand, luminosity is how much energy the star itself is actually emitting. It's measured using the unit watts, or joules per second. It's no accident that this is the same unit we use for light bulbs. In both cases, we're measuring the amount of energy being emitted as light each second. Also note that in both cases, not all of that light is visible. Remember how we saw a few chapters ago that standard incandescent light bulbs emit most of their light as infrared. That's why a 100-watt bulb emits only 20 watts of visible light. The rest, we just can't see. Astronomers think of the luminosity of a star as the truly fundamental quantity. A star's luminosity is the same wherever it is. This is the same as saying a 60-watt bulb is a 60-watt bulb, no matter how far away it is.
Brightness is more complicated because it depends on distance as well as luminosity. If you have a 60-watt bulb a kilometer away from you, it looks much fainter than it does when it's right up next to your face. The same is true of stars. The farther it is from you, the fainter it appears. So brightness, distance, and luminosity are all tied together. In the next few slides, we'll keep going back and forth between them, but we'll start out with a way of measuring distance that is independent of luminosity.
There are several ways of measuring distance in astronomy, but we'll start with just one: parallax. When you drive down a road and look at the scenery outside the car, it often seems that things in the foreground fly past quickly, while objects farther away hardly move at all. This is the basic idea behind parallax. When you change your position, objects nearby appear to shift their position a lot, while things farther away change much less. If you know exactly how far you've moved and how much the angle the object has moved by, you can calculate how far away it must be.
For thousands of years, people have been able to use this to measure the distance to the moon. However, it wasn't until after the invention of the telescope that this parallax shift was measured for stars, because stars are so far away. And even then, it required us to use the Earth's orbit as a baseline.
As the Earth moves around the Sun, nearby stars shift back and forth in our sky. This change in position is tiny, less than a single arc second for even the closest stars in the night sky. This diagram greatly exaggerates the apparent motion. If we did this to a more accurate scale, the star would have to be tens to hundreds of kilometers above the top of the screen. We can use this angle, known as the parallax angle, to calculate the distance. D equals 3.26 light years divided by P, the parallax angle measured in arc seconds. Notice that the smaller the angle P the star appears to move, the larger the distance.
A star that has a parallax angle of 1 arc second would be 3.26 light years away. Note that this is closer than any star except the Sun. A star with a parallax of half an arc second would be 2 times 3.26, which equals 6.52 light years away.
The best parallax measurements can have an uncertainty as small as a few hundred thousandth of an arc second. So parallax can be used to measure distances of 100,000 light years away or more. By the way, if you've forgotten what an arc second is, just review the telescope section.
Here's an experiment you can try yourself. As you do this, you can answer the questions on the next slide. First, hold up a finger, an arm's length away. Then try looking, first with one eye, then with the other. As you do that, notice how your finger appears to shift around compared to the objects farther away. Then try the same experiment, except with the finger held up close to your face. Notice the difference in how much the finger appears to move against the background this time.
Let's look at a specific example of calculating parallax. This is a good time to talk a little about uncertainty in measurements. All measurements have an uncertainty, so it's good to know how this affects how well we know the result. Imagine a star with a parallax of 0.35 arc seconds, meaning it moves 0.35 arc seconds back and forth in the sky each year. How far away is it? If there is an 0.01 arc second uncertainty in this measurement, what is the possible range of distances? The first part is very straightforward. Just plug in the parallax angle into the formula. This gives a distance of 9.3 light years. But since our measurement is uncertain, it could be larger or smaller. To know how much, we need to include the uncertainty in the parallax measurement.
To find out the range of possible distances, we first add the uncertainty to the measurement of the parallax. 0.35 arc seconds plus 0.01 arc seconds gives us 0.36 arc seconds. Then we put this into the parallax formula, and it gives a distance of 9.1 light years. Now we do the same thing, but we subtract the uncertainty from the parallax angle, giving 0.34 arc seconds. When we put this into the equation, we get 9.6 light years. So in fact, the distance could be as little as 9.1 light years and as much as 9.6 light years.
Now it's your turn to try one of these calculations. If a star has a parallax of 0.04 arc seconds, how far away is it? If the uncertainty is 0.005 arc seconds, what's the possible range of distances?
Remember this table? You should be using it to help you keep track of the equations we use in this course. Fill in the distance equals 3.26 over parallax section of this table now. Keep it and update every time we use a new equation. You'll find this page useful doing homework and reviewing for exams. Depending on your section, you may be required to submit a copy of the completed version for credit.